we're kicking off a five-week series in a church-wide initiative based on Bishop Robert Schmaese's book, The Five Practices of Fruitful Congregations. There are many different ways for you to invest yourself in this series. We have a daily devotional that we're challenging everyone to read together each morning. If you do not have a copy of this devotional book yet, we do have, I see about three more copies here on the chancel rail. And if you if we need to order more, we can. This past week, you should have been reading Radical Hospitality to get ready for today. If you missed this past week, go back and double up. But they're all short. It takes about 2 minutes to do each day. So 4 minutes if you're behind, all right? But get caught up. There's some good stuff in this book that'll really guide what we're talking about. Another way that you can get involved in this initiative is by completing the surveys. 2 weeks ago, you would have gotten a survey for Radical Hospitality in your bulletin. This week, you got a survey for Passionate Worship in your bulletin. Please, please, please fill out those surveys. I'm going to tell you why again. Another way is you can get involved in small groups. We have five small groups that have begun, that are beginning. That each small group will focus on one of these aspects that we're going to be covering. So we are going to cover Radical Hospitality, Passionate Worship, Intentional Faith Development, Risk-Taking Missions and Service, and Extravagant Generosity. And so we have five small groups, one for each of those things. They're going to be meeting at various different times. It's a three-week commitment, so you're only committing 3 weeks. And the schedule can be found on the church website, or I also have smaller schedules of when those meet out here on the hospitality table that you can take home with you for information on when those are meeting. We're challenging you to be a part of that. So whichever one you feel drawn to, if hospitality is kind of the thing that you love and you want to be a part of that, you feel like our church can do better in hospitality, be a part of the hospitality group. If you think our church should be more intentional in the way we develop small groups and the way we teach our children, our youth, be a part of that. Or you can be a go-getter and be a part of all of them at some point. That is kind of up to you, whatever works for you. But please be a part of those conversations. I believe that God has placed this congregation of Harpersville United Methodist Church here in this location, here in this city, and has sustained this congregation now for over 200 years for a reason. I believe that he has drawn our unique set of members and regular attenders here to be a part of something new and unique and incredible that will reach the city of Harpersville and impact the kingdom of God like never before seen in this area. I believe that he will impact and he will do some incredible things that we can't even ask or imagine. But we cannot simply sit back and wait for God to move. You and I must offer our hands and feet. Jesus was God's hands and feet on earth. And then he now sits in heaven, and the Holy Spirit is within us. And so Christ has no hands but yours, and Christ has no feet but yours. And so we must offer our hands and feet to God. So my prayer is that over the next 5 weeks, that we become more aware of who it is God is calling us to be as a church, so that we can truly experience what it means to be a church on the grow. That's your mission statement, to be a church on the grow. I want us to truly understand what it means to go reach others with the love of Christ. And I feel that this five-week initiative is really going to help us grab a hold of that. In his book, Robert Schmaese and others, they did research on the top growing churches around the world. Some are mega churches, some are mid-sized, some are small and rural like ours. In this study, it didn't matter the size of the congregation. It did not matter the size of the budget. What they all had in common were these five practices. Radical hospitality. And now I want to call your attention to the adjective. Not, they didn't just have hospitality. They had radical hospitality. And they didn't just have worship. They had passionate worship. And they didn't just think about faith development. They were intentional about their faith development. They didn't just do missions or send money to the mission field. They took risks in their missions and their service. And they didn't just give to give. They extravagantly gave. And so I believe that God has created this church to participate in the mission of God in unique ways. And we are not looking for a cookie-cutter church. We're not looking to be the church down the street. We don't have to be the most modern, cutting-edge church that's ever existed. But what we must do is we have to figure out what it is that God is calling this congregation to do through these five practices. And then we have to do it in the most excellent way that we can. We do not serve a God of complacency. We do not serve a God who is stuck in the past. We do not serve a God that does things with lackluster. We serve a God with great imagination, with great creativity. We serve a God who is perfect in all of his ways. We serve a God that does all things with excellence. And if we are created in the image of God, then we have no excuse to be complacent. We have no excuse to do things with lackluster. We have no excuse to be stuck. Instead, we must find out what it is God is calling us to do, and then do it in the most imaginative, creative, and excellent way possible. We believe that this season of church-wide study and worship is absolutely vital for the congregation and the vision and the life of our congregation. It provides us with an opportunity for us to learn some common language that we can all use together. It can provide us the opportunity to consider where God is leading us. The leadership of the church will be taking the surveys that we all fill out. They will be taking the comments and the things, the conversations that happens in these small groups, and they're going to use them to help set goals for our church. So this survey is not just a piece of paper you're putting in the offer plate. This is actually a tool that the church leadership is going to be using. Then, on February the 4th of next year, February 4th of 2018, we're going to have our Vision Sunday. We're going to call it our 2020 vision. We want to have perfect vision of where God's leading us. February 4th is going to be our 2020 Vision Sunday. So after this season of surveys and conversations this fall, after 21 days of prayer in January that we'll be telling you more about coming up, we're going to present five goals that the church leadership feels God's calling us towards. And we will present these five wildly audacious goals for where we want to head in the next 3 years, so that we can reach these five goals by the end of the year 2020. And that's why we're calling it our 2020 vision. It's because we want 3 years to put these visions in place and these goals in place and to get them where they need to be and structured correctly so that we can be a wildly better church, a fruitful church. But those goals are going to be set from your conversations and your surveys. So that's why it's important that you participate fully in this church-wide initiative. So participate, please, because in 3 years seems like a long way off. 2020 seems like a long way off. But we're going to set short-term goals as well. So you'll see these small little goals come out for each year, 6 months, or that kind of thing, pushing us towards that 2020 goal. A couple weeks ago, Lila and I, we were shopping for some things for the house. And we went into a store that shall remain nameless, and we were shopping for some decor, and they carry that kind of stuff. At the checkout counter, I handed the cashier the items that we wanted to purchase. She asked Lila if we had found everything we needed. And then I asked her about the return policy, and she told Lila what the return policy was. And then I put my debit card into the slot and put in my pin code, and, you know, paid for the items. She handed Lila the receipt and then told Lila that she hoped that she had a good day for us to come back. I am 6'1", 350 pounds, with a deep voice that carries pretty well. That lady saw me standing there. I do not know what I did to that lady. I have no clue. But I have not felt that much disrespect in a long time. Normally, I don't let that kind of stuff go. I would call her out on it, but I was shocked. I was like, what in the world? I mean, I know she saw me. Then the other day, I went into a restaurant. I walked in, and everybody working there knew my name. I didn't even have to place my drink order. The waitress already had it. She had my cup in the fountain, pouring my Mountain Dew before I even sat down at the table. When we were getting close to finishing up the meal, the owner brought out a plate of a couple ribs. Now, I was already stuffed because you get a ton of food at this place. But he brought out a couple ribs because he was trying a new way to smoke his ribs. He wanted to know if I thought they were meaning-worthy. These two different places were two totally different experiences. The first place where Lila and I were shopping, they may never get my business again. I mean, they're a little out of the way. You have to kind of be going there to get there. Their prices aren't any better than Hobby Lobby. So why go back, you know? Why risk getting ignored again? The second place is my absolute favorite barbecue restaurant. It's Lazy Boy Barbecue. They have a food truck. They have a restaurant in Alabaster. They've got a smokehouse in Helena. I've known the owners for a little while now, but I wasn't best friends with them before I started eating there. They attended our 11 o'clock traditional service over in Alabaster. I was only in that service very rarely, so I didn't really get to know them very well. The first time I ate there then, so I'd only been an acquaintance with them. And I didn't know any of their staff. But because of their hospitality, I went back again and again and again. Like every Wednesday, every Tuesday, every Friday. Like we ate there all the time. But when I told them that we were moving to Harpersville, one of the staff members, one of the waitresses cried because she wasn't going to get to see me as often as she had gotten to see me. So I go out of my way to eat there whenever I can, and I'm trying to find an excuse to get them to bring their truck over one Sunday and set up out in the parking lot for us all. They'll do fundraisers from their food truck, so we'll find something to raise money for and bring them over. But I'm telling you, best barbecue ever. We've all had these types of experiences, though. We've all been treated like we didn't exist and the company didn't care if they had our business or not. But we've also all been treated with wonderful experiences where we instantly knew that it was a place that we could feel like home. There was something about this place we wanted to go back. We all want this sense of belonging. There's this special thing, this special feeling about belonging somewhere. When you walk into a cafeteria on your lunch break at work or at school, and someone has saved you a spot at his or her table, when your favorite barista or waitress knows your drink order and pulls it up for you, when you walk into your favorite bar and everybody knows you, all like to feel like we belong. And I use that word belong very intentionally because many times we like to welcome our guests. We like to put out the welcome mats. We like to say that we're welcoming. But there's a big difference between welcoming and being a place where people feel like they belong. And that major difference is radical hospitality. When we welcome someone, they are gladly received. They are welcome to be observers of our actions. They're welcome to eat the food that we're serving. They're welcome to visit. But then people wear out their welcomes, don't they? When we have family coming in for the holidays, it's about to be Thanksgiving and Christmas time, people will come in, we will welcome them into our homes, and then we will welcome them to leave and go back to their homes because we are finished with them, right? People can wear out their welcome. But when someone belongs, it means it's different. It means they're a part of the group. They don't have to wonder if they're going to wear out their welcome because they belong there. In our scripture this morning, Paul is writing a letter to the church in Rome. This is the longest letter that we have that Paul wrote in the New Testament. The letter includes the core of Paul's teachings about what it means to be faithfully and obedient as Christians. Throughout the letter, Paul looks at various aspects of the life of the church, and that's what's going on in chapter 12. Paul is telling the church, be sincere in your love for one another. Be devoted to one another. Honor one another above yourselves. Don't settle for complacency. Don't lose your zeal and spiritual fervor. Be joyful, patient, faithful. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. That word hospitality comes from the Greek word philoxenia. We talked about philo back in the summer when we talked about the different types of love. So that word philo means love. And then xenia means stranger or foreign. So hospitality, literally translated from the Greek, means love the stranger, love the foreigner. Paul is saying, look, it's important that you love one another. It is. It's important that you share with the Lord's people who are in need. It is. But it's just as important that you love the strangers and love the foreigners. So in my office, we pastors, when we move, we like to leave books that we have too many copies of, or we just don't feel like taking those with us, or they're old and outdated, so we let somebody else deal with them. And so one of your previous pastors were so kind to leave back some books for me. But one of the books, I've not read the book, but I saw the title of the book. And I sat this book on the top bookshelf with the title page facing out because it struck me and it convicted me. In this book, it's by Ruth Graham, and it's called In Every Pew Sits a Broken Heart. And as I pray for you during the week, I pray for you because I know many of you come each week with broken hearts. I know many of you come with things that you're dealing with and things that you're coming with on your mind. And so this book reminds me to pray for you each week and the broken hearts that you bring into worship. But it got me to thinking, if in every pew sits a broken heart, what are the things that breaks our hearts? And what broken hearts might guests and visitors and strangers and foreigners or whatever word we want to use to describe these people, what types of broken hearts, what things are breaking their hearts? Why are they even coming into worship? So what is it that brings people to visit a new church? I would say that most of the time there's three reasons people would come and visit and try a new church. First, they just moved to the area. They're new in the area. They had to say goodbye to friends, say goodbye to family, say goodbye to jobs. They're taking risks on a new job or a new location. They're having to say goodbye to an old way of life, and they're looking for a new place to belong. They're brokenhearted. They're grieving their losses, and they're nervous about if they'll find anywhere to belong in this new place. Number two, they're leaving a church they've been at for a long time. They may have even were baptized there, and now they've made the decision to leave because they're brokenhearted. They've been hurt at that church. They feel like they're no longer useful there. And so they're grieving the loss of friends. They're grieving the loss of their home church, and they're nervous if they'll ever find a new place to belong again. Will they be hurt at this new church? Will they feel like an outsider if they go to a new church? Number three, they're new Christians or they're non-believers, and they're finally given this church thing. They're finally struck up enough nerve to give it a try for the first time. And they're nervous about this thing. Do they even belong in a church, much less this church that they're trying? And so in all three instances, when people come and visit our church, they're asking that question, do I belong there? Do I belong there? Paul in chapter 15 of Romans goes on to say, you should accept one another just as Christ has accepted you. So what would it mean for our congregation to welcome a stranger in the same way that Christ welcomes us? What would it mean for us to anchor our acts of hospitality in the response to God's grace and acceptance in our own lives? Radical hospitality involves extending an invitation, not to simply be welcoming somewhere, but radical hospitality is extending an invitation to belong. So how do we do that? How do we make sure every single person that comes through our door feels that they belong here? In his book, Leading Beyond the Walls, author Adam Hamilton dedicates an entire chapter titled, The Little Things Matter. In order to become a place where people belong, we have to focus on the little things. Hamilton suggests that hospitality begins well before a person ever even walks through our doors. First-time guests, they make a decision if they will return the next week before they ever enter the building. They make the decision in the parking lot. Does the church building look well maintained? Do people actually care about the church property? Are there potholes in the parking lot? Are the flower beds maintained? How easy is it to find a parking lot? Is there signage leading into the building, letting people know which door to enter? Then when they walk in the building, is the narthex, is it clean? Is it well lit? Is it cheerful? Is it easy to find their way to the nursery or the restrooms by either signage or greeters? Do the bathrooms appear to be neat and clean and well kept? For parents of children, does the nursery smell like mold or dirty diapers? Or is it bright and colorful and clean and cheerful? Do the nervous parents know that the nursery worker has a way to contact them if the child has an emergency? His book is full of valuable resources on several topics about growing our radical hospitality. But I want you to think about this. Think about the last hotel you stayed at, either on vacation or a business trip. It's one thing to arrive at a hotel after a long trip, drag yourself and your tired family in there, drag all your luggage in there, figure out where you need to park your car, which door is best to park beside, be told your room number, handed your room key, stick it in a pocket or stick it somewhere, drag all your stuff in the elevator up to your room, down the hall, then you can't remember where you put the key, so you got to drop all your luggage in the floor of the hotel hall, find your key, get in your room. The hallway smells like dogs and mold and smoky, and you're not sure if you should walk around in your hotel room in your bare feet or not, or in your sock feet. That's one situation I've found myself in several times. Then it's a completely different experience to drive up to a Hilton or Disney World Resort. You are met at your car by a bellman and a valet. The bellman takes your luggage for you. The valet parks your car for you. You arrive at the check-in counter to a bottle of water. They ask you how everything's going. You mention that you had a little trouble at the airport, and so they comp an entire meal for your family one night, even though it was not their fault that anything happened at the airport. You then go to your room. Your luggage has already arrived. The room is at 72 degrees and comfortable, and everything is clean and smells wonderful. Both are hotels, but one understands hospitality and the other doesn't get it. Now think about this. If Hilton and Disney World gets it, if they understand the guest experience and radical hospitality is the key to set them apart from the rest of the world, and they get that radical hospitality is the key to return guests, then why do they do a better job at radical hospitality than the church does? Come on, the church has a better product to sell. And now I don't want to water the gospel down into a product, but stick with me for the analogy for a minute. We have the best product available to mankind, eternal life and a relationship with the Creator of the universe. We have the best product there is, but we're letting people outdo us in our radical hospitality, in our ability to keep return guests and give them this product that we're trying to give them. Yet when people pull in our parking lot, they have to guess which door to enter. That they're not greeted by anyone that can relieve their stress and offer them help. That they don't even know if we have worship bulletins because they sit up here on the front because nobody's willing to handle one. And I'm not talking about major changes here. These are little changes that we can make to be more radical in our hospitality. I've seen a small church. They simply painted their nursery and trained their nursery workers on how to handle children that age. And word started to spread around the community. Buzz started to spread that this church cares about children. And their membership grew from 45 to 55 simply by painting the nursery. The main thing is that we have to be willing to risk something. We have to be willing to take risks and create a buzz and stir in the community. And that strengthens participation in all the ministries of the church. Word of mouth is the most important form of human communication. When we talk about our congregations as places that make people feel loved and welcomed and belonging, then the church begins to thrive. And before we go any further, I want to tell you, our church did incredible things last night in the way of this, in creating buzz and community and showing our community that we care about kids and families. There were about 30 of us here from the church last night, and we hosted almost 300 people. That is incredible. We hosted almost 300 people on our property. When's the last time that we had 300 and something people on our property at one time? It's incredible. It's created such a buzz and a wonderful launching place for us in the community to let them know that we care about family and kids. And so now I think there's two myths that we need to address in the room. Myth number one, we are a very welcoming congregation. I'm sorry to tell you, but that's a myth. We are not. We are all either literally family here. We're an Adair or a Baker, right? we're either a Smith. We're all literally family here, or we have all grown up together and we are like family here, if we're not literally family. And there are times when a church's greatest strength can actually be its greatest obstacle to radical hospitality. We're so close as a family that we haven't left room at the table for other people to join us. And so we have to think about that. How can we remain as close as we are, as a close-knit family, but yet leave room at the table for other people to join us? We have to find that balance. The second myth is we live in a small town. Everyone here is already a Christian and goes to church, so there's not much room for numerical growth. That's a myth. There's something called a Mission Insight Report. All moving pastors receive a free copy of this report from the conference. And so I got a report. I knew more about you before I got here than you probably know about yourself, simply because of this report. This report is a detailed survey of the demographics of a 5-mile radius around the church. And so I want you to listen to some of these statistics about Harpersville. Average age of persons living in this area is 41. The target range for this area is 35 to 54 and their children, which are 5 to 17 years old. The secondary target range for this area is 65 years old and older, meaning that those are the main age groups living in this area, 35 to 54 and 65 and older. And that's about the demographics of our church. Only 19% of the people living in a 5-mile radius believe that it's important to attend religious services. Only 19% believe it's important to go to church. Only 46% of the 5-mile radius claim to be Christians. That's some low numbers. Here are the top five reasons people in Harpersville do not attend church. Number one, religious people are too judgmental. Number two, religious people are too focused on money. Number three, people don't trust religious leaders. Number four, the church wasn't relevant to their lives. And number five, there are no good faith communities in Harpersville. Now listen to this. The top five reasons people who do not attend church The top five reasons people who already attend church are considering leaving the church. Three of them are the same, but listen to these two. Number three and number four, the reasons people are considering leaving churches. They didn't feel welcome or useful, meaning they didn't feel like they belonged. And number four is conflicts that they're having in their religious community. Only 19% of Harpersville attends church services. Only 46% claim to be Christians. That leaves 81% of the population around us that are unchurched. On any given Sunday, 81% of the people in this area are sitting at home, going fishing, grocery shopping, doing anything else besides attending church because church wasn't relevant to their lives and they feel like there's no good faith communities in Harpersville. Now, folks, I don't believe that. I don't believe that church is not relevant to lives. I don't believe that there's no good faith communities in Harpersville. I'm in one right now. This is a wonderful faith community. I've experienced myself. But here's the problem. Perception is reality. And when people perceive us to not be welcoming, when people perceive that there's no good faith communities in Harpersville, that is their reality. And so how do we change that? How do we change people's perception? We host trunk or treats and show them that we care about children. We create buzz. We find ways to be relevant in their lives. We offer new small groups, new ministries out of our church that speak to what they're going through, new ways for them to process things that they're dealing with in their lives. We take risks. We create space for people to feel like they can belong and be useful. And so who's responsible for this? Who's responsible for the hospitality in our church? Brandy has started a new hospitality team. So are they solely responsible for the hospitality of our church? Do we put a sign-up sheet on the bulletin like we do for mowing the grass and breakfast on fourth Sunday? And those people are responsible for the hospitality in our church? Hospitality is not a community. Hospitality isn't something that we have to plan. Hospitality is something we are, something that we just do, something that just flows natural. It doesn't take a planning committee for us to show people love. It doesn't take a person deciding who's going to hand out a bulletin for us to be hospitable. That is hospitality. Treating people as if it is Jesus himself. Not waiting for them to get here. Not waiting for them to get here and then be reactive to their needs. Rather being proactive. Anticipating the needs of our guests before they ever arrive. Right now, we do not have a person that attends our church that sits in a that needs a wheelchair. But one day we might. I hope so, one day that we might. And then it'll be too late to anticipate their needs. Sure, we may not have a family with a bed baby with us right now, but I hope one day we might. And at that point, it'll be too late to anticipate their needs. One day we don't have anybody that attends our church right now that doesn't know what a sanctuary looks like or the layout of a normal church. But I hope that one day we will. I hope that one day we have someone come and attend that has never even seen a church building and doesn't know which door to go in because they don't know what a typical sanctuary is supposed to look like. How are we going to anticipate their needs? How will we anticipate and be prepared so that we can treat them like we would treat Jesus himself? Because I don't know if you realize this or not, but when we love a stranger, we are actually loving Jesus himself. Matthew 25, Jesus tells a parable of the sheep and the goats. And he says, come on into heaven, come on into paradise, because you gave me something to drink when I was thirsty. You clothed me when I was naked. You visited me when I was in prison. And they asked, when did we do these things? We never saw you in prison. We never saw you thirsty or hungry. When did we do these things? And Jesus tells them, when you did it to the least of these, when you did it to my brothers and sisters, you were actually doing it for me. And so anytime we love a stranger, anytime we practice hospitality, anytime we welcome those to a place of belonging, we are in fact welcoming Jesus. And so my question for you this morning, what steps will you take? What steps will you take personally to make our church a place where everyone belongs, especially those people who look like Jesus? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.